Okay, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us again for our second interview with Professor Richard Wolff. The first time we talked about basically the problems with capitalism and how it's failing us and how the pandemic has shown us that. And today we have half an hour with Richard again, and we're going to talk a bit more about maybe some optimism or how to go forward and move towards a post-capitalist society. So if you don't know who Richard Wolff is, which I think you should by now, but if you do not, Professor Wolff is Professor of Economics Emeritus at the University of Massachusetts Amherst and a visiting professor in the Graduate Program in International Affairs of the New School University, NYC. He's the founder of Democracy at Work and the host of their nationally syndicated show, Economic Update. His latest book is The System and the System is the Sickness, When Capitalism Fails to Save Us from Pandemics or Itself. And it is available with his other books, Understanding Socialism and Understanding Marxism, at www.democracyatwork.info. So Richard, thank you so much for joining us again to continue this conversation.
Mexie, I'm glad to be here. I'm glad we're having a second version or a second continuation of it.
Absolutely. So this time I'm just going to ask a couple questions and then open it up to the chat. So I wanted to start with, you know, you're a big advocate of building worker cooperatives and of democratizing workplaces from the bottom up. So could you give us an idea of how democratized workplaces and decentralized production could have helped us cope better with COVID and perhaps could have helped us mitigate some of the economic recession that we're now dealing with?
Sure. Let me start with the easiest example to give, that it goes something like this. In a capitalist system, a very small number of people, group of people, make all the key enterprise decisions. We call them employers. There's no mystery about it at all. And if you edit, put all the employers together in a big stadium, it wouldn't be more than 2 or 3% of the American population, to take our country as an example. And it would be the same percentage in other countries. The vast majority of people are employees, not employers. So you are doing something remarkable when you put the economy, on which we all depend, into the effective hands of a tiny minority and give them all the power. You know, the employer decides what the enterprise is going to produce. And this is true whether it's a factory, an office, a store, doesn't make any difference. A tiny number of people, the employer, the board of directors, if it's a corporation, the owner of the business, if there is one, et cetera, the major shareholders, you put them all together, as I say, 2 to 3% of the population. They make all the decisions, what the enterprise is going to produce, what kind of technology the enterprise is going to use, where the production is going to take place, and then the really big one, what to do with the output that everybody, all the employees and the employer, whatever they've done, whatever we've produced, this tiny group of people decides. For example, we're going to sell it in the market. Okay. And then they get the revenue from that. Okay. And then they decide what to do with it. What happens to all the other, the employees, the vast majority? They are told a very interesting thing at the end of each day. Go home. Get out of here. Go back home. Have a beer, maybe some pizza, and then come back tomorrow and do it all again. Oh, and by the way, what you helped to produce today using your brains and your muscles, that's ours. That stays here. You go home, but the product belongs instantaneously to us, the employer, even if we didn't do anything to lift a finger to produce it. It's ours. It's the way the system works. And we will do with it what we want. And the decisions of those 3%, the employers, we, the employees, have to live with them, whether we like them or not. And we have no input. We don't have a veto power. We do not elect these people. We have absolutely nothing to say. We are required to live with decisions we cannot participate in. That's the opposite of democracy. So if you are committed to democracy, whatever you think is the way to express it, you are, when you go to work in a capitalist system, you are saying goodbye to democracy. When you cross the threshold into that office, into that store, into that factory, you are entering a place where a tiny minority of unaccountable people at the top tell you where to go, what to do, what desk to sit behind, what machine to use, in what way, on what raw material, and at 5 o'clock, get out of here. You know, I like to make the joke that there's a reason why the bar that you pass on the way home from your job has in the window happy hour, because it knows, like you do, that those other hours where you are a drone being told what to do, those are unhappy hours, whether you admit it to yourself or not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For me, this is the root of the problem. To take the example of the pandemic, mm-hmm. mask producers in America, and we have those. We have factories that can produce masks.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Those people knew that masks are used when you have a pandemic, a viral pandemic. This is not the first one like this. We've had these all over the place. And we can see on TV over the years, people running around with masks. I mean, no rocket science here. They could have produced those masks, but they didn't. And so now the question becomes, why didn't they? And the answer is crystal clear. They will tell you, but you don't need them. The answer is, it wasn't profitable.
Mm-hmm.
And they're right. It wasn't. And it's very easy to understand. If you make a mask, let's say you make millions of masks. Okay, now you got to put them someplace. You put them in warehouses. You locate the warehouses where the people are concentrated in our country. So in the cities and, you know, all like that. And in the warehouse, you know, they sit. And when they sit over time, they can kind of get dirty and you have to clean them, or they can wear out and you have to replace them and you have to monitor them and you have to see. It's very expensive to produce them, to warehouse them, to maintain them. And for how long? Answer is for however many years until the next virus shows up. This is impossible. We are not going to make it. This is too risky. We're not doing this. We have 10 other more profitable ventures we can devote ourselves to, so we're not doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have what I love as a critic. I am now able to say, if public health and safety in the face of viruses which have been with us for millennia, they're as old as human beings, I'm sure older, if we're going to have public health and safety vis-a-vis a virus, capitalism is not the way to do it, because mm-hmm. capitalism failed us. Now, we know what could have happened. What could have happened is that the government comes in and says, don't worry, the private capitalism sucks at this business. It's no good for public health. So we're the government. We're going to compensate for the failure of private capitalism. But of course, in the United States, with the ideology we have, no politician can say such a thing as I just said, right? It'll offend the private capitalists, and we can't have that. So we don't have it. But the truth is, that's what the government does. It's coming in and says, okay, private capitalism stinks at this little detail called public health. And so we're going to do it. And the government could do it. It could buy the masks as fast as they come off the assembly line, giving the companies that make them a nice price that gives them a nice profit. And then the government takes over all the risk and responsibility for storing it and cleaning it and replacing it until the virus comes. We could have done that, but ideology, among other things, blocked that too.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the worst of it, Mexie. The government is already doing that in another area. I love to point this out.
Mm-hmm.
Shows you how profit works. It turns out that it is equally unprofitable to produce a missile, a gun, an airplane, a tank, a rifle, all the paraphernalia of war, military stuff. Same problem, because if you produce a missile, if you're a missile maker, what are you going to do with your stupid missile? You're going to put it in a warehouse, and then you're going to have to clean it and replace it and monitor it. And what are you waiting for? Unknown number of years until the next war comes along. It's like waiting for the next virus. That won't work. Private capitalist, there's not enough profit there and too much risk. So we know what the government does. It comes in and has a cozy relationship with the military producers. You produce a missile, we'll take it off your hands as it comes off the assembly line. We'll take care of storing it, locating it, cleaning it, monitoring it, securing it, all the rest. Taxpayers, you and me, we pay in the end to take that risk off the hands of the private capitalists who are guaranteed a profit by the defense contracts that they sign with the government. And that's exactly what we're talking about. The government does it for the military. It didn't do it for our public health. Mm-hmm. Here's the double irony. Number one, we've already lost 210,000 people who are dead in this country. That is a worse fatality than most of the wars this country has participated in its entire history. Mm-hmm. Well, there is no sense in the way this is working. This is fundamentally irrational. Number two, when we teach economics, which I've done most of my adult life, we are instructed to teach that capitalism is a system that is based on efficiency, that what capitalists do is figure out the most efficient way to produce things. And isn't that wonderful? We don't waste anything. All right, here's an example of capitalist efficiency, if you want one. Any estimate one could make of what it would have cost the United States to produce all the conceivable masks we could want and store them, and ventilators and gloves and hospital beds and all of it, is a tiny fraction of the amount of wealth we have already lost, and we're not even through this. Mm-hmm. So this is the most inefficient catastrophe imaginable. Mm-hmm. All the little efficiencies accumulated by companies that can scrimp and save a little over here and make sure the light is turned out at the end of the day when the workers go home, all those little efficiencies are completely negated, overwhelmed by a monstrous inefficiency of the sort. And I'm not even getting into what the value is of 210,000 dead fellow citizens. Mm-hmm. Just the monetary loss, output not produced, unemployed. I mean, it is awful. Mm-hmm. And so it stands as a critique. This is no way to function. This is a system that is busted, broken, ineffective, screaming its incapacity and its failures to a world that even the amount of endless propaganda about efficiency and capitalism, and it can't drown out the noise of its failure is beginning to overwhelm the BS that it pays for.
Absolutely. Even the Pope just came out and said that capitalism isn't working.
Pope Francis, by the way, for those who haven't seen it, this relatively short encyclical, Fratelli Tutti, I believe is the name, that Pope Francis issued, is as strong a critique of capitalism as you're going to see, and way better than most of the politicians who even dare go in that direction are able to say. So it's remarkable.
So Amanda's question is about does your new book address our need to transition away from capitalism, and what's our next step? And that kind of ties into the next question that I wanted to ask, which is basically that within this broader capitalist system, existing cooperatives are forced to compete with one another and with other businesses to some extent. So I'm wondering how existing cooperatives could potentially coordinate resources or cooperate. And do you see this as a path forward towards some kind of post-capitalist economy, be that socialist, anarchist, communist, whatever?
Yes. My new book does address that. And so let me also comment on it here. Yes, I am now convinced, and I wasn't until relatively recently, that we are living through the decline of capitalism. I know that capitalism has been very resilient for 400 years, and that's an impressive record. So I know I could be wrong. I'm not I'm not dogmatic about it. But for the first time in my life, and you can all take it for what it's worth, I think it's over. And I don't know exactly how that plays out or what it means for our lives, but I think we're experiencing now an accumulation of unresolved problems that are typical of a society that has kicked the can down the road as many times as you could, and it's now catching up to you. We have a health crisis that we can't handle. We have an economic crisis that is the worst in this new century, second only to the worst of capitalism's entire history, the 1930s, and we may yet beat that record. Mm-hmm. Our racial difficulties are coming to an explosive head. We are still in the stage of a women's revolt that comes out of the whole sexual abuse catastrophes that we have pretended weren't there for all this time. Look at it. I could go on. We have the climate crisis. We have fires burning in the West that are terrifying. And we had an earlier batch of them in Australia. And it's just, whoa. And we can't, you know, these are difficult problems, each by itself. But the collection, the coming together, that's why we've had several years in which one of the most impressive tropes in our arts have been movies about tsunamis and monsters and earthquake. This is the artistic intuition, which is always profound, that it's falling apart. So I'm afraid I have to add, as a professional economist, it looks like that to me too. It's falling apart, which means we do have to ask Amanda's question. Where do we go? What do we do? And that's why I focus on worker co-ops. That's a new place. That's another way to organize our society. You know, for a long time, societies were organized around two positions, master, slave. Tiny group of people were the master. Most of the people were the slaves. The masters made all the decision. They told the slaves what to do. You all know. Then we got rid of that, and we replaced it with something different, we thought. Lord and serf, feudalism. Mm-hmm. And it was different. The serf wasn't anybody's property, no minor matter. No human being is the property of another human being. But there was some similarities too. A tiny group of people called lords, maybe 3% of the population, making all the key decisions for the mass of people who are serfs. And then that system was overthrown by people who wouldn't tolerate it anymore, and we had capitalism. And it is very different. There's nobody who's a slave, and there's nobody who's a serf tied to the land, and none of that. It's a deal we make. I work for you, you pay me a wage. And yet it too had a similarity. 3% of the people made all the decisions in the workplace. The employer took the position of the master and the lord, and the employee took the position of the serf and the slave. So for me, the solution is stop it. Bring democracy to the workplace. Make it something that is owned and operated by the workers themselves. One worker, one vote. You decide collectively, democratically, what you're going to produce, what technology you're going to use, where you're going to do it, and what you're going to do with what you all helped to produce. Mm-hmm. No, we are talking in a country, an area of the world, let's call it North America, where you're supposed to take the concept of democracy really seriously. Well, if you did, and I want to be provocative here, if you did, you'd have to ask yourself the question, why have we excluded democracy from the workplace for the entire history of our societies? Mm-hmm. By the way, in the way that Native Americans didn't. The Iroquois, the only ones that I know a little bit about, had a very democratic way of deciding hunting and the gathering and the agriculture and so on. They didn't have a tiny group who told everybody what to do.
Yep.
We do that. That's capitalism. And I think we got rid of kings a few centuries ago because we didn't all want to be subjects with some king who could be, for all we knew, the mentally challenged child of the previous king. that this was nuts what we were doing, and that we would prefer to have a situation where everybody got a vote and we elected people to a Congress or a parliament that would make these decisions and not be left to the whims of an individual who had to be born to somebody. And we got rid of the kings. But here's the joke, and it's not a good joke. The kings are still with us, but they're inside the workplace, and they changed their names. They're now the boss or the CEO, and they still have that kind of power inside the workplace that we wouldn't allow outside. What is that? Why? Where does that come from? And I think, to say it in a sloganizing way, but it captures it. If you want an economy to work for all the people, you've got to put the people in charge. You cannot put a tiny minority in charge and then be surprised that they arrange things that are good for them. Capitalism is wonderful for the top 5%. They are rich, they are secure, their wealth is growing relative to everybody else's, they live in palaces, they are surrounded by in gated community. You know it all. We all know it. That system is good for them, but not for us. And it's about time we kind of face it. And the way to deal with it at the base, foundationally, is to say, change the enterprises. Make all enterprises a collective effort of the people in it, in co-respective relationships to the communities in which they live, democratic residential governance, democratic enterprise governance, work these two together. That's a new and different way of organizing society that we have to go.
Yeah, that's really, really well said. At first I thought, well, it would kind of have to be at both levels, right? So you'd have democratizing the workplaces from the bottom up and then also organizing to take control of the government, because as you said at the starting, if we're going to do things that are good for like the general public good, then we kind of need the government to step in some way if those things are still really expensive. But then, yeah, hearing you talk more about this, I thought that, you know, part of the reason why the government works so much for the market or the CEOs or whatever is because they've been able to amass an ungodly amount of wealth from the system of, you know, being the kings of the workplaces. And so with that wealth, they have an undue influence over our democracy at the state level. So if nobody was really amassing that level of wealth individually, then maybe things would look differently at the state level as well. I don't know what your thoughts on that. Also, Joe said that in his estimation, there are two possible outcomes, a rise in progressivism or violent revolution.
Yeah, so, I think Joe has a point. I'll come back to Joe. let me deal with yours. It's a very old and basic problem. If you are a large society, and if you allow wealth to concentrate in a very small part or portion of your society, this is true whether it's a village or a city or a country or the world, you immediately have an enormous tension. First of all, the rich, they understand what we're talking about very well. They understand that they have an enormous amount of wealth relative to the average person, and that the average person outnumber them. And if you have a political system that is committed to universal suffrage, in which everybody or every adult has the right to vote, then you are immediately in danger if you're a very rich person, that the majority aren't, and that the majority will control the government by voting, and that they will undo the results of the economy. They will change it because they don't like it. They don't want you to be terribly wealthy, and they can't feed their family or get their kid through college or any of the other basics that they think of as basics, if they do. So the rich people have understood that their wealth is jeopardized. It's vulnerable, deeply so. So they better do something. They can't undo universal suffrage, although if you know the history, those people fought it every step of the way. But you can't undo that. That won't work anymore. Okay, so what do? Number one, you take a big chunk of your wealth, don't be stingy now, and you give it to the political parties that you want to be in office. You give it to all of them. If there are five, dish it out to five. Europeans do it all the time. If there are two, as in our country, dish it out to both of them. Major American corporations, give to both parties. Okay? Why? Because then all these parties are not going to take the steps to undo your wealth because you've made them dependent on you. Mm-hmm. Here's another thing. Flood the economy. Spend a lot of money full of academic studies by professors with good reputations from the best universities explaining that whatever the government is doing for these rich people is really the best thing for all of us. Mm-hmm. You know, it's childish what's going on, but that's the game. And they've been quite good at it, mm-hmm. which is why we are in the mess that we are in. They have to do that. Otherwise, we're going to vote in. Well, let me give you an example. We will vote in Bernie Sanders.
Yep.
And Bernie Sanders is committed to a much more progressive tax structure than what we have. And that's a polite way of saying he's going to move wealth from the rich to the middle and the bottom, which reverses what the last 40 years in America have been, which has been a redistribution of wealth the other way. Mm-hmm. Right? They know that. They know that real well. And that's why they support Mitch McConnell and the Republicans and Trump and prefer Biden to Bernie Sanders. No rocket science difficulty here. Mm-hmm. Let me, if I can, Mexie, respond to another thing you said. I know we're running out of time, but it's so important. Mm-hmm. One of the things that has to happen when capitalism goes, which I believe it is in the process of doing, is that we're going to understand that our ways of thinking were shaped in profound ways by that capitalism, and that we have to kind of adjust. It's a little bit like a farm person coming into the city, or vice versa. You have to, different rhythms, different ways of looking at the world, different ways people connect to each other. Those have to happen. And here's one, competition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there's always been competition. Ancient Rome had competition, and Greece had it. They didn't have capitalism. Competition is one thing. Capitalist competition is another. So in capitalist competition, if my enterprise produces a better widget than yours and can do it at a lower price, everyone's going to buy my better widget at a lower price, and you're going to be destroyed as a business. You're going to go bankrupt. You're going to feel terrible. You're going to have to fire your workers. You're going to go, death.
Mm-hmm.
It's very dangerous, very scary.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't have to be that way. Let me give you an example. Inside a large American corporation, there are divisions. Suppose one division doesn't do well. Do they simply say, okay, you're gone, you're fired, you're dead? No. They don't do that at all. They figure out, okay, let's reallocate. We don't need 400 people in that division. It's not doing that well. Let's see. Maybe it'll do better. But for the time being, we'll take 50 of those people and move them over there because there we have something that's growing and that needs more people. And say and nobody has to worry that if your division has a difficulty, you're dead. You're gone. You're finished.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, a worker co-op society would do exactly the same thing. Let's suppose we have a worker co-op. And for whatever reason, they're inefficient. Maybe people don't like what they produce anymore. Whatever the difficulties, they can't sell whatever it is that they make mm-hmm. in the quantity they used to, only half. Mm-hmm. In some way, then, in some rough sense, half their workers are, in a sense, not needed there. Well, in a capitalist system, the employer immediately says, you know, you're fired. I'm not going to pay you wages if I can't sell what you helped to produce. But a worker co-op would say, that's crazy. Having a person who continues to eat, to wear clothes, to use shelter, he's consuming, but he's not producing, that's irrational. He wants to produce, he's a healthy worker. Our job is to find him another place. So we will arrange, okay, if this area is shrinking in its demand for labor, here are areas in our community that could use some more workers. Maybe to help old people, maybe to reclaim an ecologically damaged region, maybe to do a Green New Deal. I mean, who knows? But there's always plenty of things to be done. And the system would guarantee the enterprise is not going to fold. It's going to be smaller. Another mm-hmm. enterprise is going to be bigger. And when the wind changes, it'll go the other way.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not going to allow the competition, and we'll keep them. They should compete. That way we get improvement over time. We want that. We want innovation and all that. So we will have competition, but we will not allow it to work this way as it did in capitalism. That has to be understood. Otherwise, you're going to think, oh, my God, how different is it really going to be? The worker co-op is going to be as tight-fisted and hostile to its own members as any capitalist employer was. And the whole premise of this system is, no, we're not going to do that. We're not going to treat human beings that way. That's why we're not capitalists, because we don't want that kind of arrangement. We want a worker to understand it is the obligation of society not only to give you a safe way to be born into this world and a safe, dignified retirement out of it, but we are also going to give you a decent job with a decent income as something you can rely on. Now go out there and develop your mind, your spirit, your hopes, your dreams. Go out there and make a better world, but you don't have to worry about whether or not there's food on your table, that there's a job for you to go to. We're just not going to do that to you because it's socially irrational and personally destructive. The only way you can justify it is if you have a system based on private profit. If you want to give a small group of people the position in society where they can fire you if and when it is more profitable to them, which is what we have, if that's what you believe in, and if that's more important to you than giving the mass of people what we are capable of giving them, then you are really a pro-capitalist person. But I think that's as tiny a minority as our capitalists themselves. The majority, if given a half a chance to pursue what I'm saying, would do it. You know, Italy is a wonderful example. There's a province in Italy, in the north of Italy, around Bologna, called Emilia-Romagna. It's a part of Italy. And in that economy, for decades now, about 40% of all work is done in worker co-ops. It is the most developed regional worker co-op system in the world. And they fought for it, and they've kept it there because the mass of people want it. There you can see how they work, what the interactions are between capitalist enterprises and worker co-op enterprises, how the politics is shaped. But the notion that we can't do it or that it isn't possible, that's all wrong. And that's mostly based on keeping Americans, I'm talking here loosely, but keeping a lot of people, not just Americans, unaware of that. The fact that worker co-ops are a very old idea, not new, been around for thousands of years, are much more in the world today than you know about, because we haven't yet, that's what I'm working on, become aware that we should be paying a lot of attention to them because they contain the seeds of a new world. And, you know, like with anything else, there's no guarantee those seeds will germinate and grow and all the rest. I think it's now a possibility, and the collapse of capitalism, I'm hanging on to this metaphor, the collapse of capitalism provides the fertilizer for this.
Yeah. No, absolutely. That's so interesting. I actually hadn't heard of Bologna and their worker co-op setup, so I'll definitely look into that. As a chronically ill person, moving towards that kind of a system sounds wonderful to me. And I agree with you that I think that capitalism is absolutely circling the drain. And if we can both attack it, you know, kind of from the top down, but also build something up like the sharing economy, you know, that can take its place, I think that's definitely what we should be working towards right now.
I think so too, because, you know, as I look at the collapses of previous history, systems change not because a new idea comes along and not even because a new idea catches hold and inspires people. It mostly comes to an end because a system can't solve its own problems anymore. And I think that's where we are. We are just unable. And the United States has gone from the leader to a country about whom we can say we are 4.5% of the people of the world and we're 25% of the world's COVID cases and 25% of the COVID deaths. We're a rich country with a developed medical system. That is such a failure on such a scale. You're going to never live that down. This is going to be for the United States, as the leader of capitalism, what the bubonic plague was for feudalism in Europe, the beginning of the end. But I think that what happens is when a society implodes, breaks down, it's at that moment, the key question is, who has some idea of where else to go? It's sort of, what do we do now? I mean, we've had it with this system. We will not take it another day. It's the revolution, it's over. But that leaves the huge question. And at that point, it doesn't matter whether it's all that many people. If there are at least a few people who say, well, here's a direction that gives us a good reason to believe if we try that, we will get a better out. That's what worker co-ops are. That's why it's important that they're around, that we're talking about them, that we're thinking about them, because when that collapse comes, which is really the timetable of capitalism, when that time comes when everybody wants to see the alternative, the question will be, how much have we spent thinking about it? How much time? How well developed are some of our ideas? How many times have we gone over them, challenged each other around them? That will determine how effective we are at that moment in giving the end of capitalism a new direction.
And I think it's really important to actually practice that stuff, right? So if we actually want a world where workers own the means of production and, you know, we have a democratized government, like you actually have to practice, what does it mean for me as a worker to engage with other workers, you know, on equal footing? And because you don't just, we've been completely socialized in the opposite direction. So you don't just one day wake up and know how to do that. Like it takes a lot of communication and problem solving and a lot of things that we don't know how to do.
Exactly. And that's why Emilia Romagna is so interesting, because if 40% of your regional economy is worker co-ops, it means that a typical Italian family having a picnic on a Sunday afternoon in a neighborhood park, gathering together the cousins and the aunts and the uncles and all the rest, they're going to have people in that picnic from both the capitalist sector, people working in a regular, and somebody working in a worker co-op. And they're going to talk about the they're going to have their gripes and their things they're happy about, but you're going to learn about it. And one of the reasons I'm so confident in the worker co-op is the people of Emilia Romagna have built, have grown their worker co-op sector. When everybody knows about it, it doesn't disappear. People want it. It's the capitalist sector that's more worried about its long-term viability. The worker co-op sector has a sense that it is emerging. And you have that in Spain, too, around the Mondragon Corporation, which is the Spanish version of this. They, too, are very good, big and strong and growing. And I mean, they have their problems, don't forget me. We're not talking about nirvana here. We're talking about a change that will bring its own problems. You know, it's like the old story that my grandmother told me, that she warned me when I was thinking of getting married, that not to think that marriage will solve all my problems, which frankly hadn't occurred to me, but she was worried it might. And she wanted me to understand that when you get married, you exchange one set of problems that go with being single for another set of problems that go with being married, and that you have every right to prefer one set of problems to the other, and so you make the change, but it's not going from problem to, you know, heaven. And if you have that mentality, you're going to be in for a rough ride.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm conscious of your time. We've gone over time here. Do you have to head out now?
No, let's go another few minutes.
Okay, so so Joe said, but how do we pay for it? Is anyone else sick and tired of hearing that? And this reminded me of, we got some other questions in the last stream about how you feel about, I guess, modern monetary theory and the importance of government debt.
Yeah, well, whether you take modern monetary theory is a way of restating old ideas and also dropping a few of them that were hard to hold on to. The basic idea is that the government issues money, and it can issue it whenever it wants to get things going that it wants to get going. And if and when this activity leads to being inflationary, that is, there's too much money running after the goods and prices start going nutty, you pull the money out, and that undercuts the ability of people who afford paying those high prices. Mm-hmm. Now, I think it's a corrective that's valuable over what existed before. Mm-hmm. But it is, like always, prone to a bit of excessive enthusiasm. Well, we can then fund everything. Mm-hmm. No, you can't. And you have to be careful. If an inflation comes, when you pull the money out, it doesn't impact everybody the same. That's a very politically loaded process, mm-hmm. which is why it's so hard for societies to pull back. It's so much easier to pump in.
Right.
So, but put all that aside. When the we've had three crashes, and here's the way I would answer it. Three crashes in the 21st century. The so-called dot-com crash of the market in spring of 2000, the subprime mortgage crash in 2008, and now the COVID-19 crisis in 2020. Three crises in the first 20 years, each one worse, much worse than the one before. Mm-hmm. In these situations, in each of them, the government suddenly panicked as millions of people lost their job and tens of thousands of businesses went belly up. Mm-hmm. And no one batted an eye. It took a matter of days to spend unspeakable amounts of money, billions and then trillions of dollars, to keep this capitalism from blowing itself up. Mm-hmm. Anyone who looks at the amounts of money involved and then responds to the notion, what about something as fundamental as giving the economy diversity? So it isn't all the capitalist type of top-down hierarchical enterprise, but we also have a worker co-op sector, a place where we take democracy seriously inside the workplace. And we have the two so people can see what it's like to work in one or the other, or what it's like to shop from one or the other. And we begin to have an informed population that can then decide democratically what kinds of systems it wants. Mm-hmm. Right? That should presumably be a very important thing, fundamentally changing the country. Mm-hmm. And it costs a small fraction of what you're spending to keep this broken system from complete collapse. Mm-hmm. Let me make sure your audience understands something which has so far escaped attention. Mm-hmm. During this COVID crisis, the Federal Reserve, which prints the money basically, mm-hmm. either physically ordering the bills and coins or electronically creating the accounts, mm-hmm. They have begun lending directly to corporations. Here's what that means. Any corporation in America, any business that has a problem, the public doesn't like what they produce, is not buying it, or they have a fight with their workers, or their technology is out of whack, or whatever, they now have one way to solve their problem that is easier, quicker, and cheaper than all other ways. Mm-hmm. Borrow money. Why? Here's how it works. The corporation goes to the bank, local bank. I need a $12 million loan. Fine, says the bank. It takes exactly 10 seconds to say fine. It really doesn't care. Why? Because within minutes after we sign the papers that Bank X lent $12 million to Company Y, Bank X takes that debt, that promise that I give them to pay that debt back, and sells it to the Federal Reserve, getting fresh new money. Who owns the actual debt? The Federal Reserve. Who's the ultimate creditor of the American corporation? The government. Mm-hmm. Any libertarian that you encounter who tells you that the United States is split between a private sector and a public sector isn't paying attention. Mm-hmm. There is no private sector left. Mm-hmm. Everybody is on government life support, mm-hmm. not just a worker getting the extra few hundred bucks in his or her check because they have no job. Mm-hmm. But every corporation, not just those getting the special programs for the pandemic, but those that now know that the amount of money they can borrow is limitless and the interest rate just a smidgen above zero. Free money as much as you want. Therefore, you shouldn't be surprised by this statistic. American corporations are more indebted now than they have ever been in the history of capitalism anywhere.
Wow.
This is a story that doesn't end well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're going to be unable to pay, and then the government's going to have to forgive their debt. And then everybody else who has a debt is going to be screaming bloody murder because my debt didn't get forgiven. What is it? And the stark favoritism to corporations over everybody else becomes more and more visible amid more and more suffering. That's not sustainable.
Yep.
And when the earlier question asked about violence or revolution, that's not because the left, it doesn't have the power to force that issue.
Mm-hmm.
That's the system itself breaking down. The real question should be rephrased.
Mm-hmm.
How far will the people who sit at the top of this system, how far will they go to hold on to it, even though it's finished?
Yeah. And it's going to be a pretty scary and tumultuous, I guess, fall down that we're in for coming up. I don't know when, but not too far off. So Jonathan says, how would a startup worker co-op compete with the global market capitalists have access to?
Yes, that's a good question, Jonathan. It's been asked for as long as I can remember. And here's the way to answer, not with a speculation, but with a little history. The most successful worker co-op in the world at this point is this thing called the Mondragon Cooperative Corporation. It's based in the city of Mondragon, Spain. That's the northern part of Spain, right up against the Pyrenees Mountains that separate Spain from France. It was started in 1956 by a Roman Catholic priest, Father Arizmendi by name. And he gave a famous speech to his parishioners. And he said, if we wait for a capitalist to come in here and hire us, we'll all die of old age before it happens. Everybody laughed. And then he made his great suggestion. Why don't we become our own employer? Then we don't have to wait for some capitalist. Let's set up a business and we will be both the employer and the employee. So he, together with six local Spanish people, started a worker co-op, 1956. So fast forward to 2020, right now. This corporation is the seventh largest corporation in all of Spain. It has over 100,000 employees. They are grouped into about 200 worker co-ops under one corporate umbrella. They have competed successfully against countless capitalist enterprises. By the way, their co-ops include agriculture and industry, manufacturing and services and everything. They've competed very successfully. That's why they've grown like this. This kind of growth in half a century would make any capitalist proud. But here is a worker co-op showing, by the way, it can go from small to very large. It can compete with capitalists and outcompete them, survive. Many of the capitalist companies they competed with along the way couldn't compete, went out of business, and sold their equipment to Mondragon, and their workers then became also joined into the Mondragon. And here's in a way what might be the most important point for you to understand. They've been so successful, they have their own bank. They've been so successful, they run their own university. The Mondragon University have been there. They teach courses in how to organize a worker co-op, how to finance it, how to grow it, how to deal with personnel problems. I mean, imagine yourself in a business school program learning how to run businesses, only the businesses you're learning how to run are worker co-ops, not capitalist enterprises. Okay, they've done all of that. They are very, very successful. They have their problems, but they are very successful. They managed to show how to compete. And by the way, it isn't that hard. in a capitalist business, the division between the 3% at the top who run it and the 97% who don't creates all kinds of tensions, hostilities, envy, bitterness, abuse. You know it. We know it. We know the sexual abuse that's been in the mail, that women have suffered in corporate structures, you know, forever, and all of that. You don't have that in worker co-ops. Because most of them have a system of rotation. So even if you're temporarily in a position where you're directing other workers, you will soon be in the position that one of those you directed is now the director, and you are now the directed. And so you're not going to do what you do. I mean, the golden rule will be everybody's rule. You can't do to others what you wouldn't want them to do to you, and they will be in that position before too long. We have a system of equality built into the enterprise, whereas you have inequality built into the capitalist enterprise. It's just it stands to reason you're not going to have the same kind of experience, and that translates into productive efficiencies. A simple story: you're a worker who's pissed off about how you're treated. You notice on your way out of the office at the end of the day that the light in the bathroom is still on, but it's not your bathroom, it's not your business, and you're hungry, you want to go home and have your dinner, so you go home, and the light stays on all night. But if the business is partly yours, if you've been in on the meetings where you notice how much of the profit of the business is eaten up by the electric bill, you're going to stop. It's the same notion as if it's your home, you take better care of it than if you're renting from somebody else. If it's your car, you take better care of it than, I mean, maybe it shouldn't be that way. Maybe we'll get to a point at some point where it isn't, but it is now. And so there are all kinds of competitive advantages. That have been shown. There's a woman, in case you're ever interested, Virginie, it's the French version of Virginia. Perrotin, P-E-R-O-T-I-N. She's a professor of business at the Leeds in England, Leeds University Business School, conservative place. She's the one who's done the best studies. She compares businesses that are similar in almost every way, except one of them is capitalist and the other one is worker co-op, to see, to compare practically, empirically, what the differences are. She's been doing this research for quite a while, and she's the leader in the world for doing this. Her results are wonderful. Capitalist enterprises do not last as long as worker co-ops. They are less efficient and less profitable. When you actually look, you see what it is your theory would lead you to reasonably expect anyway. But there's nothing to worry about. Mondragon shows what can be done, just as Emilia Romagna does. By the way, in the Bay Area in California, worker co-ops started about 30 years ago and called the little bakery in Berkeley, California, the Arizmendi Bakery, in honor of that Catholic priest in who started.
Wow.
That bakery is still functioning. Only it's now part of a chain of 6 bakeries, all of which are worker co-ops in the Bay Area. It's another story of the successful growth and expansion of this way of doing business.
Wow. That's so remarkable that the Mondragon has their own university. I think that's so powerful to be able to learn about, how to democratize workplaces instead of just learning, you know, neoclassical economics or whatever.
They have a very missionary, in the good sense of the word, missionary attitude. They want, and they have, people from all over the world that are interested in starting co-ops, growing their co-ops, come there to go through a real sequence of courses and studies and so forth. Now, I visited before the virus hit, so I don't know. I assume they've been affected, like all universities, by all of this. But at the time I went, it's a very well-developed university, you know, lots of equipment. I mean, it's a very successful business, as you'll see in a minute when you go and visit, if you do. And they have a whole program to welcome visitors, to show them around, to answer questions. So this is a movement that's growing. And if I can leave you with a final thought, the 19th and 20th century, socialism was defined by the notion that the government would come in and correct or offset private capitalism, make it less harsh, make it less unequal, make it less unstable. The 21st century, I think, is going to go in a different direction. It looks at the 20th century and says, on the one hand, great things were achieved by those socialists, but also horrible things were done by those socialists. We have to learn to keep what was achieved that was good and learn not to reproduce what was bad. Stalin wasn't good. That was bad. We have to face that, figure out how to handle that. All of that leads me to make a prediction, which I never do, but I'm going to make an exception. I think that the socialism of the 21st century that we're just beginning now will have a different focus. It'll hold on to a notion of a government doing all kinds of things, but it will be more focused on the base, on the bottom, where all of us live. And it'll be focused on bringing a radical new universe of equality and democracy to the workplace, the factory, the office, and the store. And out of that, to fashion a different, better society.
Well, that sounds absolutely wonderful. Looking forward to that new paradigm being ushered in. Sorry to Ben Casey and Joseph Ramirez. We didn't quite get to your questions, maybe another time. But just thank you again, Richard, for coming on the show. This was really, really wonderful. And I know that everyone got a lot out of it. So thank you so much.
Very good. And thank you also for coming on our show, Economic Update. We've had a wonderful response to it. So maybe we can keep up this nice exchange back and forth.
That would be amazing. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. Take care.
Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.